This is a sequential ECG from a 15-year-old girl who has a strong family history of Brugada syndrome. We can see that the resting ECG is normal and the Brugada pattern is unmasked by giving a flecainide at dose of 1 mg per kg. The atrial has a higher performance for the provocative testing, but this drug is not available. The provocative testing should only be done in symptomatic patients and in patients who have a family history of Brugada syndrome, and there is no role of provocative testing in the asymptomatic patient. The next is the catecholaminergic polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. This is a familial disorder which presents severe arrhythmia in young patients with apparently normal heart and has a high mortality. The resting ECG is typically normal, or there may be sinus bradycardia or prominent U wave. It is characterized by the bidirectional ventricular tachycardia, which is frequently triggered by the adrenergic surge during the vigorous exercise or fear. This is a typical ECG of a patient undergoing TMT. We find that with the exercise, the bidirectional VT pattern appears. Another same thing. Coming to the WPW syndrome. Though sudden cardiac death is rare in WPW syndrome, it's important to consider because this occurs in healthy patients and this is easily preventable by the radio frequency ablation. This is the resting ECG of a WPW syndrome patient. We see the short PR interval and the presence of the delta waves. The atrial fibrillation is the least common type but the most dangerous arrhythmia which occurs in the WPW syndrome. And the pre-excited AF is characterized by the QRS, which is maximally pre-excited, and the rhythm is irregular. And this is a typical example of pre-excited AF, where the ventricular rate is irregular, there is wide complex tachycardia, and the QRS morphology, which is not uniform. Coming to the early repolarization, the early repolarization is defined as a J-point elevation more than 0.1 millivolt in two or more adjacent lead with either slurred or notched morphology. And the early repolarization syndrome applies to the patient who have early repolarization pattern in the inferior or lateral leads and present with aborted cardiac arrest or documented VF or polymorphic VT. There are the various forms of early repolarization. The first one is a J-point elevation with ST segment elevation. In the second one, there is a, we can see a J-point elevation with a J-wave. Here is the third one is the J-point elevation with the slurred S-wave, and fourth one is the notched J-wave. The malignant J-wave pattern signifies the higher risk of sudden cardiac death and is characterized by the early repolarization in inferior leads or global early repolarization, terminal notching of the QRS complex or the J-wave amplitude of more than 0.2 millivolt, the horizontal or downward direction of the ST segment elevation. This is an ECG of a malignant early repolarization. Here we see the sinus bradycardia and the slurred J-wave across the precordial and the inferior leads. The idiopathic ventricular fibrillation. When a patient has survival of sudden cardiac death, even after detailed investigation, we rule out all the structural disease and ion channelopathy, we do not find any cause, then we have to think of idiopathic VF. The resting ECG is typically normal with a normal QT interval, and the hallmark of the idiopathic VF is the initiation by a typical short couple ventricular premature complexes. This is a typical example. We see the baseline ECG is typically normal, normal QRS interval, and there is short coupled VPC which initiate the ventricular fibrillation. Coming to the fragmented QRS. Fragmented QRS, though a non-specific marker, is associated with the increased risk of malignant arrhythmia, and it signifies the underlying myocardial fibrosis or scar tissue. On ECG, it is characterized by notched R or S wave, with the absence of a typical bundle branch block. There are various morphology of the fragmented QRS complex. Fragmented QRS is typically seen in tetralogy of fellow patient, channelopathies, and hereditary cardiomyopathies. Coming to the congenital heart diseases, the incidence of sudden cardiac death in repaired heart is around 0.9 to 2.6 per 1,000 patient year. The TOF is the most common repaired congenital heart disease which has sudden cardiac death, and the QRS duration more than 180 milliseconds and the rate of QRS progression more than 5 milliseconds per year over a 10 year periods are predictive of risk of sudden cardiac death. This is a typical ECG of a post-op TOF patient. We can see the right bundle branch block and QRS duration is more than 180 milliseconds. This is a ventricular tachycardia and the post-surgical TOF patient. We can see the typical left bundle branch block pattern with superior axis morphology, which says the origin is from the right ventricular scar tissue. Apart from the QRS duration more than 180 milliseconds and QR, rate of QRS increase, the JTC dispersion, premature ventricular complex, and ventricular arrhythmia holder are the other risk factor for the sudden cardiac death in TOF patients. To summarize, ECG is an important tool to screen the patients for sudden cardiac death, but as with any screening tool, ECG does not detect all the conditions who predispose to sudden cardiac death. In particular, the congenital coronary anomalies, premature atherosclerosis cannot be identified by ECG alone. If you note, this is just to summarize all the typical ECG finding. In HCM, we have to remember LVH, abnormal Q wave, LA enlargement, ST segment changes, T inversion. For ARVD, we have to look for epsilon wave, T inversion in V1 to V3. QT interval, both short and long, can predispose to arrhythmia. Brugada's pattern, code ST segment, we have to remember. We have to remember the malignant early repolarization. CPVT may have normal resting ECG. They can arrhythmia during exercise, fragmented QRS, and this.